I'm sure all of you can recall conversations that you've had that feel really good. The ideas flow smoothly with strong rapport. You're engaged, they're engaged. There's this energy and connection. But then there are those really awkward conversations when something feels off. The interaction is disjointed and uncomfortable, and you want it to be over with really fast, kind of like this one.
So, like, do you have a big family? Yeah. Do you? Well, I guess I have a kind of big family. I mean, it depends on what you define as big, I guess. How big? There's six of us. Cool. Do you like them? Yeah, I'm the only girl, so I don't really have sisters, but I get along with my brothers too.
So we have conversations all the time, so it's easy to take for granted that having a good conversation is easy. But then you find yourself in one of those awkward conversations, and maybe like me, you start to question just how easy this process really is. As someone who studies people who have difficulty communicating, I've spent a lot of time thinking about conversation. In particular, what it is that makes a conversation feel good. And by good, I mean productive, sure, if it needs to be, but also just engaging and deeply satisfying. Now, on the surface, conversation is seemingly simple. There are two roles, talking, listening, and we take turns playing those roles as the message is being exchanged. But if we're to answer that question of what makes the exchange feel good, we have to look well beyond the simple notion of turn-taking and talker-listener roles. We have to define the aspects of conversation that allow us to feel a sense of mutual connection, a sense of ease in solving problems and working through ideas together, a feeling of pleasure, and a genuine desire to continue that conversation. And that's where this really beautiful thing called entrainment comes in. So entrainment is the rhythmic syncing of behavior. Now, when humans interact, they modify or adapt their behaviors to become more like one another. It occurs in dance, when partners coordinate their movements towards one another, and it should occur subconsciously in conversation. So if I'm talking really fast, which is generally the case, and I'm talking to someone who speaks much more slowly than I do, I will, without conscious awareness, reduce my speaking rate to more closely match them. Likewise, they should speed up to more closely match me. Now, the idea is that we mutually adapt and meet somewhere in the middle. And this entrainment that occurs during a conversation isn't limited to just how fast or how slow we speak. It's actually a whole body event. So we see it in a lot of our speech behaviors, things like the pitch of our voices, the intonation patterns that we use, the lengths of our speaking turns, the timings of our pauses, our laughter, but also in our body postures, gestures, facial expressions, eye contact, and conducting this whole orchestra is the neural firings of our brains. We quite literally become in sync with our conversational partner, engaging in this really beautiful conversational dance. Now, in these highly entrained conversations, ideas flow smoothly, rapport is built, energy engagement is felt. Here, there is space for vulnerability, intimacy, and sincere human connection. But like a dance, syncing up with one's partner isn't always a smooth process. You see, in order to entrain, we need to be able to produce rhythmic behavior, to perceive the rhythmic behaviors of our partner, and to modify our behaviors to align more closely with our partner. So if we liken this back to dancing, we need to be able to produce good dance moves, to see the dance moves that our partner is using, and then sync up our dance moves with our partner. And just as some people are good dancers, others have two left feet. It's exactly the same in conversation. There is this wide range of abilities to engage in conversational entrainment across the population. And as we watched in that earlier video, conversations with really low entrainment don't feel good. So without rhythm and synchrony to connect us in the conversation, The interaction can be uncomfortable, unproductive, and quite frankly, disengaging. Subconsciously, we steer clear of these sorts of conversations. So we avoid people who we can't entrain with, or we keep those interactions as brief as possible. And we all experience low entrainment from time to time. I bet if I asked you to think about it, you could probably all conjure up the image of someone in your mind who you just don't seem to connect well with in conversation. It can be difficult to entrain in some situations, particularly if the person that you're talking to has a very different or unfamiliar speaking rhythm. So maybe you've experienced a disjointed or disconnected conversation when talking to someone with a foreign accent. Maybe even someone with a New Zealand accent. Sometimes we just can't quite align our rhythms, and that feeling of connection eludes us. But what if you experience that lack of connection every single day with almost every single conversation that you engaged in? I thought about this idea when I was a speech pathologist working in the hospitals. So my caseload included a large number of patients with Parkinson's disease. Now, this is a neurological disorder that affects movements, and in many cases, the movements required to produce speech. So people with Parkinson's disease often speak very quietly, with slurred or blurry or mumbled speech, a breathy, monotonous voice, an abnormal speaking rhythm. Now, this causes communication difficulties and, not surprisingly, can lead to social isolation. Now, there are a lot of other symptoms that occur with Parkinson's disease. So walking, moving can be difficult. There are balancing issues, so frequent falls are not uncommon. There can be a tremor or a shaking in some part of the body. Loss of smell, trouble sleeping, difficulty eating, and yet, people with Parkinson's disease often comment that social isolation is the most devastating symptom of them all. The impact on quality of life is huge. It causes loneliness and depression and dramatically reduces health and well-being. So my role as a speech pathologist was to work with these patients to give them strategies to help them communicate better, to combat that social isolation. But even when treatment was a total success from my point of view, my patients were using their strategies, they were talking louder, they were speaking more clearly, they still told me that it was difficult to connect meaningfully with others in conversation. That people continued to go out of their way to avoid having to have a conversation with them. That Parkinson's had taken a massive toll on their relationships with their friends and family. So I was doing everything that I knew how to help my patients communicate better, and yet I was missing something critical. This realization altered the course of my career. I left clinical practice and went into research to search for answers. So I studied speakers and listeners and conversations and breakdowns, and eventually a light bulb went on in my head. Maybe my patients with Parkinson's disease and their conversational partners have difficulty in training with one another. And this idea actually does make sense. Remember, in order to entrain, we need to be able to produce, perceive, and modify speaking rhythm, or rhythms. So for people with Parkinson's disease and a speech disorder, this model breaks down because they have difficulty producing speaking rhythm. It then breaks down for their conversational partner because now they are faced with the challenge of perceiving an abnormal speaking rhythm. So it is highly likely that Parkinson's challenges participation in the conversational dance. It's also really likely that it's not just Parkinson's. Autism, cerebral palsy, hearing impairment, brain tumors, brain traumas, stroke, ALS, MS, and more. All of these conditions can interfere with the ability to produce or perceive speaking rhythm. I believe that there are many people out there who struggle on a daily basis with the conversational dance. But we really don't have much knowledge about how this dance breaks down in the conversations of people with communication disorders. Further, if it is breaking down, we don't have ways to help fix it. So research in my lab is now addressing this gap. My team is developing methods for assessing conversational entrainment in an effort to both better understand the phenomenon in speech pathology and work towards developing treatments to improve it. As a starting point, we're focused on Parkinson's disease and the potential toll or cost that it takes on entrainment in the speech domain. In my lab, we elicit and evaluate conversations involving people with and without Parkinson's disease. We then measure these conversations along hundreds and hundreds of different speaking rhythm features in order to quantify the levels of entrainment attained, as well as other measures just about how meaningful and engaging those conversations were. And to date, our analyses have shown us basically what we've expected to see, that conversations involving a person with Parkinson's disease have much lower levels of entrainment than conversations involving two people without Parkinson's disease. Further, that these conversations with low entrainment are less meaningful and less engaging. But more importantly, we're learning which aspects of speaking rhythm are most critical for any two people to entrain on to experience a good conversation, and which aspects don't really matter. With this information, we can expand our assessment methods to other conditions that can interfere with entrainment, as well as develop treatments to improve those impairments. Can people with Parkinson's disease become better at entraining during a conversation? Or can we improve entrainment by enhancing the skills of their conversational partners, their friends, and their family? We still have a lot of research to do in order to answer these questions, but my guess, it's going to involve both. After all, it really does take two to tango. Thank you.